deliver this talk. I'm going to share my screen. I hope you can see it.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so, well, along this seminar, well, first of all, thanks to the organizers and also thanks to all of you that are today here. And today I'm going to talk about the development of alternative permanent magnets going from the synthesis of rare earth free composites to additive manufacturing technologies. As Carlos was commenting, we are working in the group of permanent magnets and application at Indiana Nanoscience in Madrid, Spain. So, most probably you know that additive manufacturing is much attractive lately in many different high technological sectors, as can be energy, transport, aerospace and aeronautics, medicine, biomedicine, and also consumer products. And this is due as with additive manufacturing technologies, it's possible to fabricate functional objects with reduced restriction in shape and with twin properties. This leads to the design of devices according to efficiency instead of according to what is available at that moment in the market. Here you can see some of the examples of the different additive manufacturing technologies. Well, let me show the here. And these technologies show different advantages, as you can see here in this list. But the main ones are that it's possible to fabricate objects with a reduced geometrical restriction, allowing to develop complex geometries. Also, it's possible to customize the design of this object according to the final application. It's possible to fabricate in a faster and cheaper way functional prototypes. And also, it's possible to reduce the material that is wasted along the fabrication process, or we can eliminate expensive fabrication and post-processing tools, as for example, is the case and that the of the molds that are used for injection molding. Here you can see the additive manufacturing technologies are divided according to the technology, are divided in seven different families. Here you can see an scheme of all of them and the different techniques that are included in each of the technology. So I'm going to comment some of them because they are the most promising in the most promising ones in the permanent magnet sector. The first one is the technology that is called powder bed powder bed fusion. And here in this technology we can find the most used one are selective laser sintering or melting and electron beam melting. In this case, the starting material is a powder that can be plastic, metallic, or ceramic, and usually is coming in particle shape that they could be spherical, for example, is the most common one, but also some different shapes. And along this process, what is done is that using, for example, a laser or an electron beam, these particles are getting fused among them, making, instead of having this material in powder, we have an almost fully dense object. With this technology, it's possible to fabricate a complex object using a wide range of materials. But in this case, the equipment and also the price of these powders is very high in comparison to other additive manufacturing technologies. Also, depending on the particle size of these materials, it's necessary to, and also of the type of material, It's necessary to handle and work with this material using a protective atmosphere to avoid the powder's oxidation, as is the case of metallic powder. And concerning the permanent magnet sector, the main issue, or let's say the main challenge at this moment, is that as with this technology, we are fusing the material locally. We have a very high temperature. So in the case of permanent magnet materials, due to this high temperature, we can modify the microstructure of our material, leading to deterioration of the permanent magnet properties of this material. So this is the main challenge, to use this this additive manufacturing technology for the permanent magnets. We have also this technology that is based on photopolymerization. And here you have the most used one. They are called stereolithography and digital light processing. In this case, what we have is a liquid photopolymer resin, and using a light with a specific wavelength, depending on the resin that we are using. Using this light, we cure, so we solidify this resin layer by layer, fabricating this three-dimensional object. In this case, it's also possible to obtain very complex shapes and with a high resolution and a smooth surface finish. The main disadvantage of this technology is that usually it's required a post-processing to increase the mechanical properties of the 3D printed object. But it's also possible to combine in these different type of resins with different type of particles of different materials. It's possible to make three-dimensional object with functional and tune properties. Here you have the other technology that is being quite used in this permanent magnet sector, and it's called material extrusion. In this technology, as you can see here, there are different technologies, but all of them are based on an extrusion process. In this case, what is done is to deposit the material layer by layer until the 3D printed object is fabricated. Here you have some examples of the different materials that can be used. For example, for polymers, thermoplastic, and the combination of these different polymers with particles, very different type of particles. They can be metallic, ceramic, and with different properties, it's possible to create a 3D printed object made of composite materials with tune properties according to the final application. In this case, the equipment are quite low cost in comparison to the other technologies, and it's possible to use a broad range of different materials. And in this case, the main advantage is that the temperature that is used along the process is quite well controlled and is very low in comparison to the other technologies, as the laser-assisted additive manufacturing technology. So it's an advantage for the permanent magnet sector, because we don't modify the properties of the starting material. Here you have some examples of the different materials that can be used. As I was commenting before, we can use polymers, metallic powders, the combination between both as in the shape of composite materials. You have some examples of these composite pellets here. And depending on the technology, these materials need to come in a shape or another. For example, as filaments, powder, resin, or inks, or in combining these different materials, well, we can have, for example, filament made of composite materials. I'm going to talk about the concept of a composite material. So a composite material is a combination between at least two different materials with different properties, leading to a material, a new material, that has the combination of the properties of the precursors. In the nature, we have some examples, for example, in the shells or bones of different animals, that by means of these composite materials, they can have different properties, such as, for example, mechanical reinforcement. Here, you have an example made in the lab using this concept of composite materials, where they were using carbon fibers with a polymer to do to the final composite material a higher mechanical strength and also thermal conductivity. Another case is the combination of particles with magnetic properties with a polymer leading to a composite materials that has the combination of these two main properties of the precursor materials. Here you have a couple of examples where they were combining, in this case, they were inks with using nanofibers and nanoparticles. In this first case, they were printing some pieces to allow for obtaining a programmable strain distribution and failure, and also to increase the damage tolerance of the printed object. And in this case, they were using iron oxide nanoparticles using a ink with this material to tune the electrical and magnetic properties of the resulting object. A new concept that is when you are printing a three-dimensional object and with, for example, by the effect of the temperature or if it's in contact with water, for example, this three-dimensional object evolves somehow or its properties are changing, we can consider that instead of 3D printing, we are having this 4D printing. That is a 3D printed object with an additional functionality. And this allow, to have object or devices with tuned properties that are particularly interesting for different applications. In our case, what we are doing at the moment at the group is to use the combination of the development of composite materials in a shape of a filament, because we are using the fused filament fabrication technology. And we are using this technology because the main reason was what I told you before, is that we are using a reduced and controlled temperature to avoid any deterioration of the permanent magnet properties of our materials. And using composite materials, we can tune the properties of the resulting composites to allow to be used for different applications. Here you can see in this graph that the permanent magnets are widely used in different nowadays technologies. For example, in energy, aerospace, electronics, and also a sector that is nowadays increasing very much and is benefiting from these permanent magnet materials, that is the electromobility. And here you can see in this graph that the necessity of these permanent magnet materials is increasing exponentially due to this development of these high technology sectors and applications. So there is a need of finding new materials, alternative materials to those that are critical at the moment. I will explain you a bit later. And to try to diversify the permanent magnet market. So here you have, you can see the historical evolution of the different permanent magnet materials. And as you can see here, the most powerful at the moment are those based in neodymium and iron boron. However, these elements, the main component, the main elements are critical elements at the moment. So there is a need of finding new materials to obtain a diversification of the permanent magnet market. There is a gap at the moment, and that's why it's very important to do research in this development of alternative permanent magnets with rare earth free, so no content of rare earth elements, or with a reduced content of these critical elements. At the moment in the group, we are working with different materials, as you can see here, trying to cover this gap between the different permanent magnet materials. And the results that I'm going to show you, they are related to this specific material, the manganese aluminum carbon base alloy, ferrites, and also hybrid materials, which is the combination between ferrite and neodymium iron bond. And the results that I'm going to show you are in the frame of different collaboration that we have with several companies. Here, the first one is a collaboration that we have since years with the company IMA, which is located in Barcelona, here in Spain. And in the second case, we are working with alloy based on manganese aluminum and through industrial contracts with the Swedish company Höganäs. So let's start for the first one. In this case, what we have been using is pellets made of the combination of the permanent magnet materials, in this case, strontium ferrite or neodymium iron boron, with a polymer. And the composite materials, in this case, were prepared by mechanical compounding, as you can see here. So in this case, we have the two starting material, and through heating and also applying some pressure, we can combine these two materials into a single one, a composite one. And after cutting this extruded material, we can obtain these pellets, as you can see here. In both cases, they are very highly loaded composites. As you can see here, they have a permanent magnet content of over 98% in the composite. And here in these SEM images, you can see how is the morphology of these pellets. In both cases, the particles were homogeneously covered by the polymer. And you can see as well that there is a big difference between the particle size of the strontium ferrite and the neodymium iron boron being like 10 times higher for the neodymium iron boron ones. This, the particle size is a key parameter when extruding and also when going to the 3D printing. I will explain you later. But you have the first example of how this particle size is influencing in this along all this process is when extruding the material. When we extrude the material, we can obtain flexible meters long filaments to be used for 3D printing. And when the particle size is small, in this case for the strontium ferrite was around 5 micrometers, you can see that the filaments, the circular cross section is very well defined. The walls of the filaments, the surface is very smooth. But in the case of the neodymium iron boron one, the neodymium iron boron based filament, we can obtain flexible filament, but if you go closer, the surface is much rough in this case, and this is due to the larger particle size. Also, we can combine these two permanent magnet materials, the neodymium iron boron particles that you can see here. They are these big pieces, big particles here in the hybrid material, with the strontium ferrite particles, which is the smaller one here. And by combining these two different permanent magnet materials with two very different hysteresis loops and permanent magnet properties, as you can see here, the blue line for the neodymium iron boron and the black one for the strontium ferrite. By combining these two materials, we can obtain permanent magnet materials with intermediate properties, as can be seen here in the magenta line. However, when extruding, as you could see before, the particle size is very important from the point of view of the morphology of the extruded filament, but also when considering the permanent magnet properties. In this case, you can see here by measuring the hysteresis loops of the composite and in comparison to the extruded filament, you can see that in the case of having a small particle size or an intermediate particle size, the permanent magnet properties of the extruded filament, they are exactly the same as for the composite. But in the case of the neodymium iron boron one, as the particle were much larger, you can see here that coercive field remains almost the same. However, the remanence and the saturation, so the magnetization, is decreasing. And this is due as when extruding, so the material is going through the nozzle of the extruder, and if the particles are very large, they are getting stuck into the extruder. So not everything what we put at the input of the, at the entrance of the extruder is going out. That's why we have this decrease in the magnetization. So as you can see here, also in the magnetic properties, is very important, the particle size. So now I'm going to show you the results that we have obtained along this industrial contract that we have with the Swiss company Höganäs. In this case, we are using the manganese aluminum based alloys, because this alloy is very promising in the permanent magnet sector, because it has an attractive combination of properties for technological applications, such as it has a high maximum energy product, a low density in comparison to, for example, the neodymium iron boron, allowing for obtaining high performance light magnets. Also, manganese and aluminum are elements that they have a lower cost in comparison to neodymium, for example, and they are widely available in Europe. Also, it has some other interesting properties from the point of view of technological applications, such as good corrosion resistance, good machinability, and high modulus of elasticity. And the thing that we need to consider is that we need to obtain this tau phase that you can see here, because it's the only ferromagnetic phase of the system. This is very important. So in our case, what we are using is this manganese aluminum carbon dope with a bit of carbon. We are using quasi-spherical particles, because they are fabricated by gas atomization we obtain a reduced particle size. And as I said before, we need this the material with this tau phase crystallographic structure. The first thing that we need to know how to do is to synthesize these composite materials, because if you remember, for using this fused filament fabrication, we cannot use directly the magnetic powder. We need to combine it with a polymer. So we have the starting polymer, the starting magnetic powder, and we synthesize the composite material. So how we do this? We use the solution casting method, because with this method that you can see here, the scheme of the different process that this method has, is because, so we use it because it's possible to obtain very homogeneous composite materials. It's easy to tune and control the filling factor of our resulting composite material. So this filling factor is the amount of permanent magnet particles that we have in the final composite materials, and is suitable for a broad combination of metallic and magnetic particles. Here you have some examples of the application of this solution casting method that we have done in collaboration with different companies. So the manganese aluminum carbon alloys, I will explain you later about these results. But also, we have applied this method not for permanent magnet application, but for aerospace and aeronautics. And we have used it using as a starting material elements or alloys that are commonly used for these sectors, as can be aluminum and steel, for example. But also we have used titanium or inconel, that are other alloys, that are elements or alloys that are used for this other application. So here you have a couple of examples of these synthesized composite materials. Here you can see just by eye that according to the amount of permanent magnet particles that we have in the composite, is getting darker and darker. And if you go closer, you can see here these SEM images where the polymer is homogeneously surrounding the magnetic particles. If we measure the hysteresis loops of these composite materials and compare in comparison to the starting powder, we can see that the coercive field remains the same after the synthesis process, and we can tune the magnetization of our resulting material according to the amount of permanent magnet particles that we have in the composite material. After extruding, we obtain this type of continuous and flexible filament. You can see here that we have meters in length filaments with a circular cross section, and with the particles covered homogeneously by the polymer that we have used for the synthesis of these composite materials. If we normalize the hysteresis loops, you can see that there is no deterioration of the magnetic properties of the composite materials and the filaments, because you can see here that they are almost exactly the same. We are very happy because this was the first time that there were reported highly loaded composites based on permanent magnet particles synthesized by these methods of solution casting and the extrusion of these manganese aluminum carbon based filaments. And as I said before, there is no deterioration of the permanent magnet properties of these particles after either the synthesis of the composite or the filament extrusion. Now, when we reach this point, is that we need to optimize the permanent magnet properties of the magnetic filament to obtain a 3D printed object with optimized permanent magnet properties. We have two different ways. The first one is enhance the permanent magnet properties of the manganese aluminum based starting powder. And the second one is to increase the filament filling factor. So how we can do this? So let's start for the first one. In this case, what we do is by following a method that was self-developed here at the group, at INDEA, that is called the flash milling method. What we do is we have this manganese aluminum based alloy. We perform a very fast and energetic ball milling process to allow the reduction of the particle size and the crystallite size. And we perform optimized annealing treatment to enhance the coercive field of this material by controlling the phase transformation along this this process. We have applied this this method not only for manganese aluminum based alloys, but also for cobalt or strontium ferrite. Here you can see, we have this epsilon phase, that is the phase that we have when we atomize the manganese aluminum based alloys. And through this nanostructuring of these materials and with the control phase transformation, what we have is the transformation of the epsilon phase, that is a non-ferromagnetic phase, into the tau phase, which is the ferromagnetic phase of the system, combined with some other phases, as you can see here, the beta phase of or some carbides, to allow for tuning the magnetic properties of the resulting particles. Here you have a couple of examples of how, by tuning this nanostructuring process, we can obtain materials with different permanent magnet properties according to the final application. Here, the black line is our starting material. And by controlling this flash milling process with the optimization of the thermal treatment, we can obtain, for example, a powder with a very high coercive field in comparison to the starting atomized powder. But you can see here that the magnetization is reducing. So if we need to obtain a powder with a balanced combination of coercive field and magnetization, we can optimize this, tune this, this nanostructuring process to obtain a material with intermediate and balanced permanent magnet properties. The second path to optimize the properties of the magnetic filament is trying to increase the filament filling factor. Our approach was to combine particles with the same composition, but with different particle sizes, as you can see here as a scheme. And here you can see some SEM images of the particles that we have used. So we have defined particles with a mean particle size of around 16 micrometers and the coarse ones with a mean particle size of 30 micrometers. In both cases, so as I said, they have the same composition and they are based in the tau phase crystallographic structure. What we did was to combine these fine to coarse and coarse particles using different fine to coarse particles ratio, as you can see here in the SEM images. And the first step was to combine these particles with a polymer using the solution casting method. In all the cases, as you can see here, the particles are covered by this the polymer that we have used, and in the case of combining fine and coarse particles, the fine particles are getting into the spaces between the coarse particles. When we extrude these composite materials, we have observed an effect that you can see here. So in our case, we found that the optimum fine to coarse particle ratio to obtain flexible and continuous filaments, as you can see here, was 25:75 in this case. And here you have another example of what is happening when you don't have this optimum ratio between fine and coarse particles. Here, if you compare the circular cross-section with the optimum ratio, it's much homogeneous, the cross-section. And here in these images, you can see that with the optimum ratio, the surface is much smooth. In the case of using a non-optimum one, you can see this sawtooth effect that you can see in the surface, and this promote that the filaments are very fragile, so they are not suitable for 3D printing. So as you can see here, this is another observation leading to say that the particle size in this case is very important. So if we measure the magnetic properties of this optimum composites and an extruded filament, you can see here that the coercive field remains the same, and the saturation magnetization, the saturation magnetization in this case is the magnetization at the maximum applied field, remains the same after the synthesis of the composite and the destruction of the filament. So with this, we can say that optimizing the fine to coarse particle ratio, we avoid any reduction in the magnetization, leading to flexible filaments with a high filling factor, as you can see here, of up to 88%. We have used these filaments to print, to 3D print magnetic pieces with different shapes, going from some simple pieces to object with much more complex shapes. And to determine the performance of this 3D printed object, what we did was to print manganese aluminum based discs and to measure the magnetic flux density and to plot these measurements, as you can see here in 3D plot and 2D map. So by scanning the surface of the 3D printed disc. As you can see here, the maximum signal that we could measure, it was measured where the disc, the 3D printed disc was located. And we did the same by reducing this diameter to check that everything was going in the same way. So you can see here that again, the maximum signal was reached where the disc was located. So after these measurements, we can see that we can use these 3D printed components to be used in sensing devices with complex shapes. Just as a summary of this, of all this that I have told you along this seminar, so it was possible to synthesize homogeneous manganese aluminum carbon based composites with the tuned content of particles using this developed solution casting method to be a material that is an alternative to those permanent magnet materials based on rare earth elements. So it was possible to fabricate filaments, highly loaded filaments with no deterioration of the magnetic properties. It was possible to obtain continuous and flexible filaments by tuning the particle size and distribution. And it was possible as well to 3D print object with a customized shape under a controlled temperature for developing a new generation of magnets. Just I would like to thank to all the people in the group of permanent magnets and application for where all this work has been done. And also acknowledge the financial support from the different industrial project and scientific and technological project. And thank to all of you for your attention.
Thank you very much,
thank you,
Esther, for your very nice presentation and very very didactic also. I think we can switch to Spanish now for the round of questions.
Sure.
Bueno, me gustaría abrir la sesión a preguntas. Yo tengo algunas preguntas, tengo varias preguntas, pero si alguno quiere comenzar. Bueno, voy empezando yo, si no. Cuando mostraste las tiras de imanes permanentes, tanto de neodimio hierro oro como las de manganeso aluminio, me llama mucho la atención, o me gustaría saber más sobre si hicieron pruebas de resistencia mecánica o algo, qué tanto se puede...
Sí, por ejemplo, sí que hemos visto, concretamente sobre las de neodimio hierro boro y ferrita y demás, sobre esas no hicimos pruebas mecánicas, porque además esas están hechas con un polímero que es bastante flexible y no, o sea, sobre esas no hemos hecho experimentos, o sea, ensayos, por ejemplo, de tracción y demás. Pero sobre los de manganeso, aluminio, carbono, sí que se han hecho, bueno, y en otro trabajo que tenemos sobre ferritas sí que se han hecho ensayos mecánicos y de tracción, y sí que se ha visto que, por ejemplo, el tamaño de partícula también influye. Es necesario, para que tengan una mejor resistencia mecánica, es necesario que el tamaño de partícula sea bastante, bueno, bastante pequeño, porque lo que haces es, cuando tú tienes las partículas, el polímero está rodeando estas partículas. Entonces, cuando el tamaño de partículas es pequeño, como que el polímero se agarra mejor, y entonces a la hora de hacer un ensayo de tracción, pues tarda más en romper, o sea, tiene una mayor resistencia mecánica. En cambio, cuando las partículas son, vienen a ser más grandes, cuando yo me refiero a tamaño de partícula más pequeño, estoy hablando de, por ejemplo, un tamaño de partícula por debajo de las 50 micras. Si ya nos vamos a los ejemplos que he enseñado de neodimio y hierro boro, que está por encima de las 50 micras, ahí ya es cuando el comportamiento mecánico es peor. Porque al final tienes o sea, el contacto que una vez que rompe y el contacto que tienes entre las partículas con el polímero es peor que si las tuvieras, si las partículas son más pequeñitas. Entonces, al final, este tamaño de partícula está influyendo en todo, en propiedades mecánicas, en propiedades magnéticas, en, de cara ya a la parte de fabricación aditiva, pues que puedas obtener factor de llenado, o sea, contenido de partículas dentro de estos filamentos, pues cuanto mayor mejor, porque en el caso de imanes permanentes es lo que se necesita.
Bien. Gracias por la respuesta. En base a eso también, hiciste mucho énfasis en el tamaño de partícula, pero sí, por ahí no en la homogeneidad ni en la morfología. Dijiste en algún momento de que tenías, en base a los resultados, partículas semiesféricas, pero no eran uniformes. ¿Vale la pena optimizar el o la fabricación de las partículas para que sean todas esféricas o no?
Claro, ahí ya lo que se... O sea, por ejemplo, en el caso de los imanes permanentes, lo que se pretende es obtener el factor de llenado mayor posible, pues al final, por ejemplo, cuando son esferas, claro, es que ahí entrarían en juego varias cosas, porque, por ejemplo, si son completamente esferas, te interesa tener una distribución de tamaño de partículas como la que hemos comentado antes, porque al final te interesa que las partículas pequeñitas se metan en los huecos que dejan las grandes para tratar de acoplarse mejor. Pero, por ejemplo, si se tiene una morfología de partícula que no sea esférica o que sea cuasi esférica, pues también permite que estas partículas se acoplen mejor. Entonces, depende un poco también, y luego también depende de la tecnología de fabricación aditiva que se utilice. Porque, por ejemplo, si se utilizan tecnologías que se basan en, pues sí, tecnologías mediante láser, sí que es necesario, ahí sí que tienen que controlar muy bien que tanto el tamaño de partícula como la forma. Ellos sí que, o sea, la gente que utiliza tecnología láser sí que es muy importante que sean partículas esféricas con unas dimensiones muy concretas para que tengan suficiente fluidez, o sea, porque al final en la tecnología láser lo que haces es, tienes tu depósito con el material en polvo y arrastras capa a capa el material que vas a ir solidificando mediante láser. Entonces, si ese material en polvo no tiene unas propiedades de fluidez, es que sí es un concepto de fluidez, a la hora de arrastrar estas partículas sobre la superficie que tú estás, sobre la que estás fabricando la pieza, pues claro, se te van a quedar, no vas a obtener los factores de llenado que pretendes, o se te van a quedar zonas más inhomogéneas. Entonces sí que es, o sea, dependiendo de eso, dependiendo del material, de la tecnología que se utilice, tanto de tamaño de partícula como la forma en sí de las partículas es muy importante.
Okay. Genial. Dos preguntas sobre la estabilidad térmica. Para que sea un imán permanente o algún otro dispositivo electrónico, adecuado para aplicaciones a la industria, tiene que trabajar entre menos 50 y 150 grados. Han hecho test de estabilidad térmica y solo mencionaste el tratamiento térmico en las de manganeso, aluminio o carbono, pero no en las de neodimio, hierro, boro. ¿Hicieron algún tratamiento térmico también?
Sí, a ver, bueno, te contesto primero la segunda. El tratamiento que aparece en la parte de manganeso, aluminio, es porque, a ver, me voy a ir a la... Y así, para que sea mejor. Vale, sí, por ejemplo, esto. En esta se hizo tratamiento térmico porque para poder utilizar las aleaciones de manganeso, aluminio, necesitamos tener que esa aleación esté con una... te iba a decir, con un contenido importante de estructura cristalina que se base en la fase tau, se conoce como fase tau, porque es la única fase ferromagnética del sistema. ¿Qué ocurre? Que cuando, es que me viene mejor a la otra para ver el diagrama de fases, cuando se preparan las partículas, las que mencionaba, las esféricas o cuasi esféricas de manganeso, aluminio, carbono, cuando se prepara por atomización gas, lo que se obtiene es un manganeso aluminio dopado con carbono, si se quiere, con una estructura cristalina que se basa en esta fase. Ay, es que no, un momentito, que no sé si lo veis el puntero. En esta fase, que es la fase epsilon, lo que ocurre es que esta fase es una fase no ferromagnética del sistema. De hecho, si se mide un ciclo de histéresis de esta fase, da tanto campo coercitivo como emanación prácticamente nulos. Entonces, claro, ese material que se basa en fase epsilon no nos vale como imán permanente, o por lo menos para desarrollar las propiedades de imán permanente. Entonces, para poder tener esta fase tau, lo que tenemos que hacer es un tratamiento térmico para conseguir a una temperatura optimizada, que ya ahí pues influyen en diferentes parámetros, pero bueno, en el caso que corresponda a una temperatura optimizada, para conseguir transformar de esta fase epsilon a esta fase tau. Y luego, mediante el proceso de flash milling que os comentaba, lo que hacemos es, porque claro, para desarrollar estas propiedades de imán permanente en el manganeso aluminio, no nos interesa que el 100% sea fase tau, sino que nos interesa tener las fases que os comentaba, que son fases en proporción dentro de las partículas, son fases minoritarias, pero que las necesitamos. Porque con estas fases, con las que os comentaba de la fase beta, estas, la fase beta o los carburos que precipitan durante determinados tratamientos térmicos, con esta fase lo que se hace es aumentar el campo coercitivo de la aleación de manganeso aluminio porque funcionan como centros de pineado. Entonces, por eso en este caso del manganeso aluminio es mandatorio, obligatorio, hacer estos tratamientos térmicos. porque si no, como si lo tenemos como fase epsilon, pues no nos vale como imán permanente. En cambio, la ferrita estroncio o el neodimio hierro boro, el material de partida, o sea, esas partículas de neodimio hierro boro o de ferrita de estroncio, ya tenían propiedades de imán permanente. Entonces, no fue necesario realizarle ningún tratamiento térmico posterior. Eso por ahí. Y luego, la otra pregunta que me comentabas, la de la estabilidad térmica, sí que hemos hecho pruebas en diferentes proyectos que hemos tenido y demás. Y como tú comentabas, o sea, estabilidad, pues eso, en el rango normal de funcionamiento de los imanes permanentes, pues de unos menos 50 hasta 150, a temperatura baja no hemos hecho, pero a temperatura alta sí que hemos hecho y sí que son bastante resistentes. O sea, porque de hecho, a ver, también dependerá de la aplicación para la que se busque. Lo que hacemos es combinarlo con diferentes polímeros. Y hay algunos que aguantan mejor o peor la temperatura. Por ejemplo, de los que más se utilizan en imanes permanentes, pues son la poliamida, polietileno se utiliza también, el ABS y demás. Estos a 150 grados no les pasa absolutamente nada. De hecho, por ejemplo, la temperatura que nosotros utilizamos para extruir o luego para imprimir está en torno a 200 grados, porque ahí sí que necesitamos fundir el polímero. Pero luego, en condiciones de temperatura de aplicación, no habría ningún problema, porque realmente esos polímeros se van a fundir o se van a reblandecer a temperaturas más altas. No sé si más o menos te he contestado.
Sí, sí, perfecto. Gracias. No sé si alguien más tiene una pregunta. Bueno, yo tengo una pregunta más, una pregunta corta. En los que son a base de manganeso aluminio, mostraste también en las curvas de histéresis.
Sí.
El coercitivo era de 150 oersted o 200 oersted más o menos, que creo que lo mostrabas en kiloampere por metro. Eso igual, o sea, depende de la aplicación.
Claro, sí, tú te refieres a
casi en las diapositivas finales.
Sí, por ejemplo, esta, ¿no?
Sí.
Sí, esto, o sea, tiene un campo coercitivo de, pues en este caso, unos 100, algo menos de 150 kiloamperiómetro, que eso en kiloéster es equivalente a unos 1,7, 1,8 kiloéster más o menos. Este hay que tener en cuenta que es el material, o sea, tal cual después de atomizar. ¿Vale? O sea, esto sería prácticamente todo fase tau y sería un material al que no se le han desarrollado todavía, o sea, no se ha desarrollado todo el potencial que tiene este material como imán permanente, porque de hecho lo que os mostraba antes aquí en otro material, o sea, en este mismo material, si se le hace el proceso este de nanoestructuración y luego tratamientos térmicos optimizados, pues pasamos de un material que tiene 1,5 en este caso, kiloéster, a uno que tiene 4,5. O sea, se ha triplicado el campo coercitivo. Entonces, es una cosa en la que pues eso, se está trabajando, se ve que es viable, porque de hecho este material tiene mucho potencial como imán permanente, pero sí que es verdad que en las otras que mostraba tiene un campo coercitivo más bajito, porque esas partículas, como queríamos hacer el estudio de cómo influye el tamaño de partícula, son partículas que han sido atomizadas y se les ha hecho el tratamiento térmico, digamos, el más básico, para pasar de epsilon, de la estructura cristalina no ferromagnética, a la ferromagnética, sin haberlo procesado más. O sea, simplemente para tener el material ferromagnético al que habría que desarrollar en las propiedades de imán permanente.
Bien. Muchas gracias, Ester. Si no hay otra pregunta, te agradezco nuevamente por compartir tu trabajo. Muy interesante lo que vienen haciendo en colaboración con la industria también.
Sí, muchas.
Bueno, nada, ahí. Entonces doy por finalizado el seminario de esta semana y eres bienvenida, Ester, a compartir tu trabajo con nosotros cuando quieras.
Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. Hasta luego.
Hasta luego.